My focus this afternoon is a little different focus. Instead of being involved in a debate, and perhaps even a heated debate, I'm switching my yarmulke now to that of being a malamed, to be a teacher, to be a professor, to go through the primary sources from which all of this debate actually took place, and that is, what is the definition of life and death according to Jewish law, the practical application of this when it comes to how we're supposed to conduct ourselves once we realize the person's dead, as relates to medical matters, and would obviously apply it to modern technology and end-of-life issues. There's a lot to be done within an hour and a quarter, but I will try to go slowly, systematically, hold up your questions until the point that I've opened up for questions. And at that juncture, I will not hold back many questions you might want to make, as long as we have the time frame with which to make the question. Now, if you turn to page one of the Maamar Makamos, the first page of these Maamar Makamos, and you need it to understand this part of the lecture, is the Gemara in Masechtas Yoma. The context of the Gemara is dealing with the halachas of Pikuach Nefesh, when they are Delcha Shabbos, when they're Delcha Yom Tov, when they override Shabbos Yom Tov, what do people have to do when they come on location, when it comes to medical care. And if you notice, it says right on the top of the page, where it says 1E in the text, Matsu Chai Mefachin. If you find a person caught under a building that was collapsed, and you found the person alive, the halach is you have to excavate the location, extract the person, and bring them medical help. The Gemara then says, well, that's quite obvious, that's Peshitta. You've got to tell me that, I understand that. So the Gemara says, L'tzricha ela afilu chayasha. The novel concept of the Gemara of here is, even though I know the person is not going to live out that Shabbos, by taking the person out of the collapsed building, he's going to be able to live perhaps another hour, another 2 hours, maybe even only 15, 20 minutes. The fact, by taking away the trauma of the building on that person's body, is facilitating to have a couple of more minutes of life in this world. The Gemara tells us over here that the mitzvah of Pikuach Nefesh is Docha Shabbos Kodesh, even though the person will never ever live to be able to observe another Shabbos in the future. That's how far Pikuach Nefesh is Docha, and the importance of what we call in Halacha, Chaye Sha'a.
I'm going to ask just one request that I forgot to ask you while I asked all the speakers, because there are people in this room that don't speak Hebrew and not even Jewish.
Everything will be translated into English.
The most you could do to translate English would be best.
It would be my pleasure. So therefore, what we have over here is the concept that even though we know the person only has momentary life, nevertheless you are halachically required, according to Torah law, to save and to give value to that concept of momentary life. It's based upon a greater idea, and that is the concept of whether we look upon the quality of life or quantity of life when it comes to Jewish law. And this Gemara source is used as a primary source to show you that Jewish law is not only concerned with quality of life, but it's even concerned about quantity of life, despite the fact it doesn't have the quality of what you would call normal, happy life. You have to preserve it, sanctify it, and deal with it until you leave this earth, and God takes your soul away. That's that major novel concept of the Talmud. Starting off, therefore, this page, showing the sanctity of every minute of life being precious. You have to preserve it, even with Chilul Shabbos. We then go down in the Gemara text to quotation D, 1D. And that is, what is the diagnosis, the prognosis of the person you find under this rubble? How do you know whether they're dead or alive? What are the signs of life and death? So I'll read the Hebrew text, but everything will be translated into English. Everybody can understand, but I'll just have to show the Hebrew text simply to emphasize certain things. The Gemara says, Tana Rabbanan Heichan Hu Bodek. Where do you have to physically check this person to see whether he's alive or dead? Now, the assumption is, and I saw before there was a little question of confusion, you have a person, Rahmanul Islam, caught under a collapsed World Trade Center. He's surrounded by all sides by rubble. And at this juncture, we are assuming nothing of his body is visible except the fact we know he's under there. So the Gemara says over here, in order to know whether he's dead or alive, and any piece of his body that's sticking out of the rubble, Rashi says, over here seems to be inanimate, there's no muscular movement, and surely there's no sound emanating, saying, help, help me get out of here. So what do we have to do to know whether the person's alive or dead, to know whether to call a medical service or to call the Chevra Kadisha? Which way do we go? Yesh omrim adiba. Some say, first of all, I skip a line. One says bodek atzot. One says you have to be bodek the nose. Yesh omrim adiba. Some say you have to bodek the heart. Now, I want to point something out to you, which is very important. The language of the Gemara is you check the nose and then you check the heart. In Rashi's text of this, which is a crucial text, the text should really read that I check the heart first and check the nose. The reason is because the Gemara is going to learn later on, as Rav Papa says, this is talking about a case where you find a person foot first. If you're finding a person foot first and you start to excavate and clean away all the rubble and you're getting from the person's feet to the head, the first part of the body that you come close to is the heart first. Only after you excavate higher do you get up to the nose. So in the logical sequence, it's talking about excavating up until to see the heartbeat. And the other says, no, I have to go even further, excavate and go all the way up to where the nose area is. How do I know that? So if you skip a couple lines, you come to Rav Papa's statement, which is quotation F, where Rav Papa says at the end, Machlokas, the whole debate whether you check the heart or the nose, if you found a person mamata lamala from feet first, avamala lamata, but if you found a person head first in the pal, came in the bodekov, as soon as you check the nose, the nasal area, and you see there's no longer any breathing, ain't tzarech, there's no reason to continue any further, because it says in the Torah, kol asher nishmas ruachai be'apav, that a person's soul, was you breathe it in through his nose, and it exits through the nose, and if that's the case, there's no longer breathing taking place, it's a sign that the person's soul has left them. Over here, the Gemara is very explicit that the only time there's even a question of being bodek the heart or the nose is when you find a person feet first. When you find a person head first, once you check and you see there's no longer respiration, the person is declared dead. The ramifications are, once the person is declared dead, I can no longer be Mechallel Shabbos to excavate, at least a Jew can't do that anymore, and then you have to basically wait till after Shabbos to deal with the burial activities. Now, on a surface level, when you see this text itself, and you see with the debate whether we check the heart, we check the nose, the question is, what are they debating? And what's the meaning of the pasuk, kol asher nishmas ruachayim be'apav? What is that being thrown into the literature over here? So I'm going to show you something, one way of learning this Gemara, and this is the way some learn the Gemara when it comes to those who want to entertain the concept of respiratory death or brain death as an alternative to cardiac death. Let me give you the way that camp learns the Gemara without even incorporating Rashi. What they say is the following. What is the debate whether you check the heart or you check the nose? They learn the debate is, what is the actual sign of life and death? Now, I want to be very careful over here. Life and death means, is the soul still in me or has the soul left me? We call that in Hebrew Yitzias and Neshama. That's a metaphysical concept. What we're interested to know is what biological, physiological phenomenon takes place in the body to indicate that this metaphysical state took place. Now, how do we know? Is there a body indicator to tell us that the soul God gave us at the time of our conception has been taken from us? Now, that's metaphysical. You can't see it. You can't see the neshama leave. But is there any indicator in the body's change of status that will indicate that metaphysical fact took place by a physical change in the body? This is the crucial point.